there are a number of bugs or software issues that tend to emerge in Solidity contracts. And I'm not going to cover all of them, but I picked one that is maybe the most significant of them. It also exemplifies some of the other attacks that you might see. And you can learn a lot about Solidity and how Ethereum works and having a correct mental model of Ethereum and things like that by looking at this particular attack. So I'm going to I'm just going to highlight this one attack just to get us thinking a little more deeply about how Solidity works, how Ethereum itself works, and making sure that we have the right mental model of things. Okay, so this is an example of an older style attack that exists in different kinds of software. And so it's an example of what you might call a function that's re-entrant, which means that once you start executing the function, it's possible to start executing again from the top before you actually complete, you finish or terminate running that function the first time. So recursion, for example, would be an example of this. This attack is sometimes called a recursive attack, anyway, this is a better, I think, label for it. Okay, so just forget about software programming and all of that type of stuff. Let's just think conceptually about something that would be very natural that we might want. So let's say that we have a user here. Her name's Alice. And Alice is managing her Ether. She's not using a simple account. She's using one of these wallet contracts. So a wallet contract is actually code that exists here. So it's a little contract that can hold money. When we looked at the user interface of Ethereum, you saw the contracts, how to create them. The main advantage of them is if you just have a simple user balance, it's hard to keep track of which transactions have been made to you without you having to go and sort of manually look at the blockchain and sort of dig down into the blockchain itself. With a wallet, then you can write little functions that can help you do simple things that are a little more complicated than the simple transferring within Ethereum. Okay, in particular, one thing a wallet could do is it could log every time it's paid. So it could write a little data into a log of events. And then a user interface that just looks at this wallet contract would be able to pull those events out a little bit easier. Okay, so that was the idea of having wallets. So it's a nice idea. There's nothing wrong with it. And let's say that Alice has this wallet contract and she's doing something with Ethereum. So there's some sort of smart contract that's set up. Maybe it's some sort of marketplace where occasionally she's buying things. So she's sort of moving money onto the marketplace. I don't know what she's buying or whether she gets it through Ethereum or maybe it comes through the real world. I'm not sure exactly how that works. Doesn't really matter. But occasionally maybe she's selling things or something like that. And so what she wants to do is she wants to retrieve the money that she has from this marketplace contract. So in my mental model of how this would work is the marketplace itself would hold Ether. It would have some sort of internal accounting system, which Ethereum, most contracts use this type of contract where basically you have a bunch of addresses of people and you would have a balance of how much you owe them. Okay, and so let's assume that in this case, her address is actually the second one. I'll do it in a different color so you can see a little better. So let's say that she has, you know, three Ether here. Her address I kind of penciled in as 821A dot, dot, dot. Okay, so you would have this little table. The data structure that you would use is called a mapping, which is a very generic data structure. You can find entries in constant time. That's the main advantage of it. It might be implemented with a hash table or something like that. But the idea is that you would come up to this, you would just, your input would be the address and then the output would be the balance. Okay, so in order for the marketplace to send Ether back to Alice, it would have some function inside of it that's defined, we'll think of it as defined this way. So what it will do is it will find the balance for Alice, we'll assume that it uses this data structure or whatever data structure it is to find that balance. So it will populate that field with the correct balance, which might be 3. Somehow it's decided that Alice is the one that needs to get paid. Maybe it's because Alice showed up and she ran a function like retrieve, and then we looked at message.sender, and then that's the person that we transfer to. Not sure, but anyways, this would be a variable like address. I just filled it in with Alice's actual address. And this is a variable called balance, and so we'll fill it with 3. And then you would have a function like transfer. So transfer is not the only function in Ethereum that allows you to move money back and forth. And because of this whole attack, we're actually going to spend some time looking at all the different options that you have for this exact function, because some of them are secure, some of them are, I mean, they're all secure if you use them right, but some of them are more secure out of the box if you don't know what you're doing. Other ones give you finer grain control. And what happens when this fails also differs between this function. But we'll circle back to that for now. We won't worry about the semantics of it. We'll just think at a very high level, this somehow sends 3 Ether to whatever this address is when it runs. Okay. So the design of this function might be that you do this transfer, assuming that this returns with no error or no exception or something like that. Then we'll assume that the balance, the transfer went through. And so now we have to reset Alice's balance to be 0. Okay, so whatever's in this balance variable, what we really need to do is go update this table. So let me draw it slightly different. So we might have it as accounts. And we will put in the address as the variable. And this mapping will return the balance. The return type of this will be the balance, and we're going to set it to 0. Okay, so in other words, find this entry and set it to be 0. Okay, so this is fine. There's actually nothing wrong with this code. You just have to be careful about what happens if this comes back. You probably want to put it in conditional, like if. Why don't we do that? So if we assume that transfer returns a false if it fails, then what we would do is we would wrap it in a if statement. Turns out that transfer doesn't, if transfer fails, it actually throws an exception. These are small details that I don't want to get bogged down with now. Okay. Now here's the key idea. The key idea is that over in this wallet contract, we want to record the fact that this transfer came in. Okay, so this transfer is going to come into the wallet contract, and the wallet contract wants to somehow record this information or wants to do something in response. Now, the big thing about Ethereum, like the number one takeaway with Ethereum, is that functions don't run unless if they're called. Okay, so it's not like normal software where you have an app and you say, you know, in an hour go do this, and in an hour it kind of wakes up and then it does whatever function you want. Apps don't run unless if somebody calls them, okay? So someone has to prod them, they have to poke them, they have to run a function, invoke a function against them for them to run. They don't run on their own, okay? And every function that runs costs money, it costs gas, and someone has to pay that gas, okay? So there's no way for this contract, you know, to run. If recording this event means running, like updating some sort of data structure inside of this wallet, it's not going to run by itself. Okay? So what the Ethereum people thought is, wouldn't this be cool? Here's what's going to happen. Whenever we transfer money to an account, and we take a look at this account and we see that it's actually a contract, it's not just a simple account. What we're going to do is we're actually going to let this contract run some code, okay? It can go do its thing, record some events or whatever it wants to do, and then it will return control to us, and then we'll continue executing our function, okay? And so this is still true today, although the parameters of how it works have been locked down because it's been problematic. But basically what will happen is this line of code will sort of execute, and then if it executes successfully, what it will do is it will actually go over to the wallet code, and it will say, okay, wallet code, you're now allowed to run a particular function. and you can do whatever you want inside of this function. And then when you're done running your function, what you'll do is we'll come back to this line of code in this function and continue executing. So let me try and draw this in a way that's very, very clear. So we'll sort of interrupt it after this line of code. We'll go over to the wallet function. The wallet function, notice this isn't code that's being supplied when this money's being transferred. This was some code that had to already exist in the wallet. Okay, so the wallet is sort of anticipating that this might happen at some future point, and so it's going to define some code in order to handle this particular case. Now, the first thing is this wallet code's going to have a lot of functions inside of it. Okay, so what is the function that's going to be called when someone transfers money to it? And so the idea was that what we would do is we would just have a convention. So by convention, it would always be a function that was named something. Now, there are ways of when you transfer it to tell for this contract to say which function in the wallet code that it wants run. But by default, you know, the person who wrote the marketplace doesn't know anything about this wallet. And so you want them to be able to sort of talk to each other without anyone, without the developers here having to know how the wallet was implemented. So the default is this. It's a function that we've already seen before, and it's just an empty function. Okay, it's called the fallback function. And it's also the function that's run if, let's say you say, hey, go over to this wallet function and run function ABC, and function ABC doesn't exist. Instead of Ethereum just saying that there's no function called that, what it will do is it will run the fallback function. It'll be like, well, I don't see a function that matches it, so I'll just run this function. And then this contract could maybe log the fact that people are running a weird function against it, and then maybe that's useful to sort of keep track of. Okay, so this is the fallback function. It doesn't have a method name. It doesn't take any parameters. It doesn't have a return type. However, it is payable. Okay, payable means it receives money. So when this three gets transferred, it's actually what's happening is this contract is running this fallback function, and it's running this fallback function by sending the money to run the function, the same way that you can staple Ethereum to, or Ether rather, to any contract that you want to run. Okay, so this is the function. It's called payable. And in principle, this function can do whatever you want it to do. Okay. And then when this function is done, when it's completed, what it will do is it will return control to the function that called it. And then this function will proceed and it will execute the next line of codes. It will complete and eventually it will fall back. Okay. Now, there's a couple issues. One tiny issue that's not the most pressing issue with this, but is something that we should consider, is who's paying for the gas to run this function, right? What if this consumes a ton of gas? Who's paying for it? Notice that Alice isn't around, right? I mean, she might have been the one that invoked this function in the first place. But anyway, somehow this marketplace decided that it needs to send some money to Alice. Whoever it was that triggered that action within the marketplace is paying for this function to run. Who is it that's paying for this wallet function to run? So you might say, well, maybe you take it out of the wallet funds itself. Well, if that were the case, then if I wanted to drain your money, I would just run a bunch of functions against your wallet and eventually it would drain your wallet. So that would be one model that you can do, but it doesn't really work that well. Okay, so the best thing that we're going to do is, a sensible proposal that's maybe not the best proposal is whoever's paying for the gas here, they're actually going to pay for this wallet contract to run whatever it wants in this payable function. Okay, so the control will transfer over to this. It will be allowed to run whatever it wants. It will return. And whoever's paying for this is also going to pay for this to happen. Okay. Then there's weird issues like, well, what if it runs out of gas here, right? The person knows kind of how much gas it would take here. So what if it ran out of gas here? Then is that going to tank this whole, like, it will throw an exception. Is that going to throw an exception that throws off this whole function? Does this whole function have to revert? Maybe this, you're transferring lots of money. Like, maybe there's some function where you're just like, okay, let's liquidate our marketplace. And so you have 100 people that you're transferring money to. And then one person has like a really long fallback function. And does that mean that the other 99 people don't get paid? Okay. So, you know, these are the kinds of issues. So gas is a kind of a nice sort of simplish concept, but it ends up being actually really complicated when you start thinking about these sort of little nitty-gritty details, okay? And so I won't write it down, but I'll just give you some of the answers to the questions that we raised. In general, what's going to happen is for this transfer function, I mentioned there's different ways of setting this up. And so some of them will allow the person to specify a gas limit, okay? So they'll say, hey, you know, go ahead and run this fallback function, but I'm only paying this much gas. Okay, and then if it runs out of gas, if this thing can't run in that amount of gas, it will throw an exception, but this function can sort of catch that exception and it can do something about it. Okay, so instead of this failing completely and causing an exception to get reverted here, what will end up happening is either this can accept the exception and catch it, or what we can do is we can call transfer in such a way where we say, hey, if this transfer fails for some reason, including it running out of gas, instead of throwing an exception and throwing the exception back to me, just return me a Boolean that says false. Just say it didn't work, okay? And then I can wrap this in an if statement, and then I'll only execute this line of code if this actually worked, if it actually returned true. Okay, so I'll list out the different ways that you might do this transfer. And the most conventional way is that you're going to really limit the gas, and you're also going to do the kind of transfer that returns a true false as opposed to throwing an exception. Okay, all right, now let's get to the attack itself before we worry about these nitty gritty details of how this works. So the attack is simple. The attack is that inside of this payable function, you can do anything you want. So one thing you can do is you can call any other function. So this function might call some other function inside of wallet, or it could call some function in some other smart contract, right? This could go say, oh, there's this other smart contract over there, go run this function against it. It could call some function against marketplace, like it can literally do anything, right? Anything that's on the Ethereum blockchain, it can run, okay? So what this will do is it will make a function call, and basically what it will do is it'll say wherever the address is of the contract that it wants to run, and whatever the function is that it wants to run, that's permissible. Okay, and so what you could do is you could design a fallback function that's payable. You could define it in some sense where what it would actually do is it would go back to this code and it would run it again. Okay, now let's think about, so this is the re-entry. And in fact, let me do it in another color because this is the key thing. And this will turn recursive really fast, so I won't draw in all the arrows of what happens. But so this is the key attack here. We'll call it re-entry. Okay, so let's think about the program logic. We have this function, it runs the very first time. It says, Alice has a balance of 3, so it transfers 3 to Alice. So the transfer is complete, it's successful. And what happens is we go over to Alice's wallet and it's allowed to do whatever it wants. And so what it will do is it will recall this same function. This function will run again to this line of code. And what it will say is, hey, what's Alice's balance? Well, it's still 3. Right, we are going to reset its balance to 0, but we're only doing that after this this fallback function returns. We're not going to do it before. And so if we call this function again before this function completes, we never reach this line of code. Okay, so what we can do is we can call this function, receive 3 ether, it comes back here, call that function again, receive 3 ether, you know, it comes back here, call this function again, it receives 3 ether, it goes back here. We could even set it up with a conditional, like if, you know, we, you know, eventually if this contract doesn't have any money to send, then, so another important question is, where's this 3 ether coming from, right? This transfer. Well, the contract itself, Ethereum doesn't know anything about the internal structure. So this is something that the contract defined for its own internal accounting purposes. But as far as this transfer function is concerned, this money is just coming from whatever money sitting in this contract. So that would include all the money from all of the users. So if there were, 10 different people here, or sorry, 10 Ether that were sitting across a bunch of different accounts, as long as you keep transferring Ether, like say you run this 3 times, then you'll get 9 out of 10 of the Ether. Okay. If you run this a fourth time, then you'll try and transfer 3 Ether out, there'll only be 2 Ether left, then it's going to throw an exception. And the bad thing about an exception is it's going to reset everything. It's going to be as if you didn't actually run this function. So you want to be a little careful about how you do this, but what you can do is you could, you know, have a little counter or something like that and run it as many times as you can. You can receive this transfer more than you're supposed to, okay? And then eventually, you know, you give up, you allow this to complete. So you run this to completion. Then what will happen is it will eventually bounce back to here. And then it will zero out your account. But by that time, you've actually received more than what's in your balance. And so your balance will reset to 0. This will complete. And then Ethereum will actually lock in this full functionality into the blockchain itself. Okay, so this is the re-entry attack. It's very devastating because when functions are coded up in such a way that they're vulnerable to this attack, then what can happen is someone can just come along and basically drain the entire smart contract of whatever money it has there. And notice you can do it a couple times. You could also do it by trial and error. Like the first time through, you could just try and run this function twice. So you get paid once, the fallback function just runs it once. Like say you have a Boolean, you set it to true, and then when you come back into this function, or maybe you have a counter, sorry, and you set it starts at 0. The first time through this function, you set it to 1. The second time through this function, you set it to 2. And then you only execute this when the counter is equal to 1. So that would allow you to just execute this callback, this re-entry, just a single time. And what that means is you'll get paid basically twice as much as you're owed. And then whatever it was, whatever the action was that triggered this function to be run, you could just rerun that a couple times, right? So you could add more money to your account and then rerun the withdraw of the account. So there's different ways anyways of setting this up, depending on how much knowledge you have of the internal accounting of the contract that you're trying to attack. But you can definitely withdraw more money than you're owed by using this attack. What do you do about this attack? It turns out there's a few things that we can do. So the first thing we could do is we could think about doing anyways is just disable this feature. The problem with this is you would require, I'd have to stop and think through the details, but I'm pretty sure it would result in what we call a hard fork. So we didn't talk about hard and soft forks, but basically if you update Ethereum substantially and change how the blockchain actually works, then what ends up happening is all the clients have to update. If they don't update, then they sort of end up working on an old version of the blockchain. And so actually what happens is you get a kind of a permanent fork where all the clients that updated, they start working on one branch of the blockchain, and then all the clients that didn't update, they'll sort of work on their own branch. The ones that did update, assuming that the more than a majority update, theirs will be the longest, so they'll always accept their own. And the other branch, even though it's shorter, they will not accept
the branch of the clients that have updated because it's doing things that to them seem illegal or against the rules of Ethereum. And so they'll keep rejecting the blocks that are added to that chain, and they'll keep growing their own chain. Okay, so this is how you end up with, it's called a hard fork. And sometimes, you know, we'll talk about an example actually that's related to this attack where Ethereum decides that it's worth it in order to hard fork. But anyway, so this is sort of, it's hard to do. And it creates a sort of political issue as well. Okay. So that's the first issue. But the second thing is, let's say that this could be resolved. Do we still actually want to disable this feature? I mean, this feature is actually sort of useful. You are giving the wallet a chance that if someone moves money into it, you're giving it a chance to do something in response to that action. At the very least, sort of record some information about where that transfer came from and things like that. It's also questionable. So the point is that this design sort of pattern is useful for some applications. So it'd be nice to not just disable it completely, and then additionally, it would be really kind of hard to just sort of turn it off. And so this is not a solution that anybody pursued, okay? The second solution is have your developers be careful. So I'll put it as developer awareness and care. And so you could basically say, okay, developers, you need to know about this attack and you got to design around it, okay? So one thing that, so when you start executing a function, you sort of jump over, execute something else and go back. We call this the flow of the code. And in particular, we call it control flow because this contract is controlling the flow. And then when we switch over here, we're actually giving control sort of to someone else, okay? Another thing that maybe I didn't make clear that let me make clear right now is that whatever's in this fallback function, it's committed. It's not like we throw control over to Alice and then Ethereum prompts Alice and says, okay, what do you want to do? Everything, all this functionality to implement this attack, it has to be implemented in this fallback function. And it's going to be implemented before Alice even passes money into this contract because she's sending it from her wallet. So that means the code of the wallet was already put on Ethereum. And as you know, that once you put your code up, you can't change it. Okay, so you know, it definitely is a situation that if Alice were to do this attack on this, she designed this wallet specifically. It's not like an out-of-box wallet that Ethereum generated for her. This is a specific wallet that's designed with the sole purpose of attacking this particular contract and only this contract. And so Alice in this case would know all the internal details of this contract. She would notice that there's a vulnerability, and then she would think about how could I design some contract on my end in order to exploit this particular vulnerability. Okay, so I want to be clear that this doesn't just sort of happen. This is something that's really arranged. And so that's good because from a defensive standpoint, we can think about there might be people who are trying to do this attack on our function. So is there ways that we could redesign our function so that it's sort of resistant to this attack? Okay, and so there's different techniques that you can use. I'll explain two. So one of them is if you want to control flow, one thing you could do is you could just sort of lock this function. So the very first line of this code could lock it. And then if you get all the way to the end of the function, you can release the lock and unlock it. So a lock can be implemented as a Boolean. And basically you have a require statement at the top that says require that the lock is true. Or let's call the lock locked. Implying that when it's true, the function is locked. So when you jump into this function for the first time, we'll assume that Boolean is unlocked. So we'll require that it's not locked. Then we'll lock it. Okay, that would be the second line of code. Then we'll do everything that we want. And if we don't get all the way to the end where we unlock the function. Then when we jump into the middle, or sorry, when we jump back into the top of the function, on the second pass through the function, that requirement statement won't hold. Okay, it will be a locked function. So we do this a lot in concurrent programming, and this is kind of a concurrent programming problem where you want to lock down a certain function so that if you get interrupted halfway through, then someone doesn't go and change things, right? So when you are interrupted and then you come back and you continue executing, you know that things are exactly how you left them because you sort of lock them up, okay? So this is called, it's simply called lock. Sometimes it's called semaphores, which are kind of a fancier lock. Another thing you can do that will help you with this attack, because it effectively acts kind of like a lock, but it also will help you with some other attacks that are based on the fact that any function can be called in. Once you put up a contract and you have 10 functions, they can be called in any order. Even though you might have a mental model of the process in which you would call this functions, Ethereum doesn't enforce them being called in a particular order. And so another thing you might use is a state machine, where you're very explicit about sort of what state is your contract in at any given time. And so you can use like enums, which is a data type that makes this state machine work well in Ethereum. There's different ways of doing it. You might use a Boolean for a lock and an integer for a semaphore. So these are very lightweight little things that can take care of it. Okay, so this is the best approach, or it's an approach that you should do anyways. I mean, there's almost no downside to it. It's not that expensive to maintain a lock. And, you know, I'm a big advocate of sort of security through depth, so trying different techniques. So this is one thing you can do. The other thing is you can pay attention to the logic of your code. And so we also got in trouble because we set the zero after the transfer. So what we might do is we might set the transfer to zero first, then we'll kind of transfer it. And if the transfer doesn't go through, we'll sort of react to that and we'll put the account back at its original balance. In that case, on the second pass through this function, the account will already have been set to zero. And so this will just try and transfer $0. Okay, so you can, that's a simple example that's very specific to these two lines of code, but you can try and sort of design your application so that the transfer happens last. So all the updates to the state happen first. Transfer happens last, after state has been updated. And, you know, this is really simple to say, but, you know, you have to be careful and you have to really know what your code is doing inside and out to try and figure out how to design around this, okay? The final thing is that these types of attacks can get really complicated. So this is a very simple attack. And originally when it started happening on Ethereum contracts and people realized that they were vulnerable, it was something this simple. But sometimes reentry, you know, it can be really complicated where you have kind of multiple functions and, you know, these attacks can be a lot harder to sort of notice what exactly you can do. And so this whole process, it's good, but, you know, it's kind of necessary, but maybe not sufficient to actually preventing these things happening in the wild, okay? And the other thing is that there's lots of people like you guys, you know, your students, you're maybe just learning Ethereum for the first time. I don't want to say don't go out and develop Ethereum contracts. You should go out and play with this, but you're going to make mistakes, right? You're inadvertently going to have these sort of bugs in them. And so it would be nice if we helped sort of developers that you know, for developers that are really experts, then they can design around this. But for developers that are not experts, it would be nice that if we could do something to help them as well, maybe in addition to this. Okay, so this is the one approach. And then the other approach is we're going to do something to try and help developers not make this mistake, even if they don't really understand what this attack is. Okay, and so the trick that we're going to do is we can't disable this feature. Okay. But what we can do is we can kind of neutralize it. Okay. We can try and we can find some existing mechanism that we don't have to change how this works, or at least we don't have to change the protocol itself, but we can kind of change how it works within the parameters that we already have for how this protocol works. Okay. And so it turns out that first off, this idea of transfer, this isn't this transfer function isn't the actual function that's defined in Ethereum. This is what we call syntactical sugar, or it's basically a macro that hides a much more complicated function. Okay, so there's a bare bones function that's actually being called, and then this eliminates a bunch of parameters that you wouldn't care about. And this is really a solidity thing. Okay, so every time Solidity sees a line of code like this, what it does is it sort of copy and pastes the full line of code that gives you a bunch of more control, finer grain control. Okay, and so if we change what transfer actually does, what is the line of code that gets called when a developer writes down the word transfer, if we fiddle around with that, then we might be able to sort of neutralize this. And the key idea here, it goes back to this idea of gas. And so this function is going to run, and in order for it to actually make a function call and come back here and then run down here and then go back, that actually costs a lot of gas. Even just this simple function call itself, that has a certain cost in terms of gas. So the idea that we have is very simple. Why don't we make it so that when we transfer money, it still throws control over to the fallback function of the program that called it. But what we're going to do is we're going to really limit the amount of gas that we give it to run. And so we're allowed to do that. So I'll show you how you're allowed to do it. But you're basically allowed to limit the amount of gas. And we'll make it like almost zero. Okay. If we make it exactly zero, that's actually effectively this option. We would effectively disable this particular feature. But as we mentioned, having this feature is sort of useful. And so one thing it's useful is for logging events. And it turns out that logging events don't use a lot of gas. Okay, going and calling another function, that uses a lot of gas, but logging events doesn't use a lot of gas. So what we're going to do is we're going to give it a tiny, tiny bit of gas so that if the fallback function logs events, it will be able to complete that. But if it tries to do something like this, like call another function, it will run out of gas. Okay, when it runs out of gas, this throws an exception, the transfer fails, and then what comes back into this contract is either the exception or a false. And so we'll talk about that difference as well. Okay. So I've said a lot, so let's try and write some of this down. Okay, so the key idea here is that we're going to choke the amount of gas. Given to the fallback function. Okay, so the key function, I'll write it out in terms of Solidity, but it obviously compiles down to some EVM code. But the key function that we use, or the key method that we use in Solidity for both calling a function from a contract and also transferring money, it's the same one, it's called call. And so it looks like this. So you start with, let me put all the parameters in one color. So you take an address of another contract. So in this case, if we want to transfer money into this contract, it would be the address, the wallet address of this function, okay? So we have an address of what it is that we want to call. The function itself or the method is called call. We have a parameter where we can specify the amount of gas that we want to stake. So we can put in some value there. Okay. We can send money along with this call. And so we can put some amount of money here. Money will be in Ether. I'll just use the dollar sign because it's... and then the final thing we do is we actually specify what is the function that we want to call. Okay, so at this address, there's some function there. We want to call it, and there might be some parameters that are associated with it as well. Okay, so we list first the function, then we list the parameters. And so this effectively invokes f of p. Okay, so this is the generic function for calling. Now, if we want to transfer money but not call a function, then we would leave this empty and we would put money in here. Conversely, we might want to call a function that exists in a different contract but not actually send money, then we would leave this blank and we would put the function in here. Okay, and specifically, when we leave this blank, what actually happens is we do end up calling a function. It's just that we don't know what function to call because we left it blank. And so that's how we end up in this fallback function, because the fallback function is the function that you end up executing when you don't know what function that you want to, what function you want to have executed. Okay, so one way that we might invoke this, if we fill in some of the values, let me show you. So what we might do is we might say address dot call. And if we want to choke the amount of gas given to the fallback function, we could write a value in here that's really small. So maybe we write in here, well, let's say we want to actually disable it. Maybe we write zero in here, okay? And I'll talk about, let me circle back to this because this doesn't behave exactly the way you might expect it. Then we can put some value here. And then let's say that we just leave the function blank. Okay, so here we have address call. The amount of gas that we're going to stake to this call will be zero. And the value that we send will make it in terms of money. So with Ethereum, when you put zero in as a particular value, what it won't do is it won't actually stake zero. What it will do is it will do a little more complicated of a decision. What it will do is it will set the gas equal to zero if there's no money being transferred. Okay, so if money is equal to zero, then gas will actually be zero. And if it sees that there's some value that's being transferred, it knows that you're going to call the fallback function. It's going to end up costing a little bit. And so what they do is they stake some amount of gas, but it's a very small amount of gas. So it's 2300 gas if money is greater than zero. Okay, and this amount of gas is it's very small, almost negligible, and it will allow logging of events, but it won't allow a function call. Okay, so this is sort of a middle world where the wallet can do what it needs to do, why we have this whole control flow passover in the first place. But it so that's on the one hand, but on the other hand, it will prevent this particular callback to this function and the re-entry of this function. Okay, so it's sort of a nice world to live in the middle. Okay, so what Ethereum said is this is a really nice kind of configuration for what this function should be. So what we're going to do is instead of making developers fill in all these parameters for themselves, what we're going to do is we're going to write a new function that basically when it will run exactly this, but we'll just drop the parameters that we don't want them to sort of have control over. Okay, so this exact function here is equal to or compiles to the exact same thing as what we tell developers to use, which is address dot send and then the amount of money that you want to send. Okay, so in other words, what we'll do is we'll tell developers, if you want to send money, use this function. And what this function is actually doing is it's actually doing this. Okay, it fills in all of these details. Okay, now the final thing is, what if this fails? What if this function fails? What's the result? What's the return type of this function here? Okay, So the return type for both of these functions, because they're equivalent, the return type is true or false. Okay. So normally the way that you would invoke this function is you would say something like, it sounds really weird when you see it and you're like, why is it being done this way? But you might do if address dot send, you know, some amount of money. And if this whole thing returns false, that transfer didn't go through. And so you won't do whatever you do next. Okay. So for example here, then you might reset the balance or something like that. So if this send works, then we'll make the balance zero or something like that. Okay. So this is the kind of the way that this tends to be invoked. And you're like, why is it if a transfer inside an if statement? But anyways, that's why it is the way it is. Okay. And then what they decided to is that also in addition to send, what we'll do is we'll make another kind of wrapper for this function, where instead of it returning true or false, we'll actually throw an exception. So sometimes you just want an exception to be thrown. Then it's going to revert all the state. Okay, so if there's ever an exception, it will revert the state. The problem with exceptions is maybe you're sending money to 10 people. If one of them throws an exception, then it's going to blow up all the other 9, right? So sometimes you want to control failures in send and have them isolated to just this one attempt at sending the money. And sometimes when at least one of them fails, you want to blow up the whole thing, okay? So what we can do is, or what Solidity does is they give you another sort of short form, which is address.transfer as opposed to .send. Okay, and this once again is just a wrapper. So you can think of it as a wrapper for require this to be true. Okay, so require this to be true. So require tries to do it, and if it doesn't do it, it fails and then it reverts. Okay. Okay, so you can use one of these two. I'll just make that true by definition. So you can use one of these two functions depending on, and so the key difference, the only difference between transfer and send is here with transfer, the return, if it fails, it throws an exception. Okay, now this is a really nice kind of solution, I guess. You're kind of working within the parameters of what's already in Ethereum. You're basically just writing a wrapper for an existing function where you kind of lock down parameters according to what you think is best. And then you just tell developers about this. You don't necessarily tell them about this, or at least for your developers who are just starting out, you only tell them about send and transfer. You don't tell them that, oh, there's actually this more complicated way of doing it that gives you finer grain control until they actually need to, you know, set the gas or something based on what they're doing. Okay. But the thing is that, let's say we just roll this out. We just throw this, you know, we make these changes. Now all developers who are writing apps like this marketplace, they're using transfer and send, okay? Let's just say that that's the case, okay? What will happen is, here's what could happen. What could happen is Alice will come along with a wallet. And maybe she wrote the wallet before everyone understood these attacks. And so when she writes her wallet, she actually has a fallback function that tries to do more than just log events, okay? She's like, okay, this fallback function is really cool. Whenever I get a payment, you know, maybe for example, every time Alice gets paid, it immediately turns around and sends the money to Alice's other account to sort of keep all her money in one place, okay? So you could write that in your fallback function. So every time a payment comes in, this fallback function gets invoked. And then what you do is you transfer that money onto another, maybe a simple contract account. Sorry, not a contract, but like just a simple account as opposed to a contract account, okay? That would consume way more than 2300 gas. And so what will happen is that when all the marketplaces, they start using transfer and send, where they're not staking any gas for these fallback functions, Alice gets kind of screwed, because what will happen to her is she won't know. She'll develop this wallet. It will do some fancy thing in her pay or in her fallback function. She'll move money onto the marketplace, and the marketplace will be like, "Great, I'll take your money, no problem." Okay, and then later when she wants to withdraw her money back out of the marketplace, that's the first time she realizes that she made a mistake. She'll try and withdraw it. It will fail because she won't have enough gas, and now basically everybody is kind of stuck because Alice can't change her fallback function, okay? She could upload a new wallet with a new fallback function, but it will be at a different address. And this 10 that she's getting out of the marketplace, that 10 is, you know, that has to do with her address here, right? In this database, that's assigned or it's allocated to the specific address of this wallet, okay? So if, right, and the code that will go fetch the balance out of this mapping and return it to this address, that's the marketplace code. And as we know with Ethereum, once you deploy code, you can't change it. So the marketplace can't change their code to say, oh, we're noticing that Alice is having trouble receiving this money because of the way she set up her wallet. Why don't we send it to a different account instead? If they didn't envision that happening in the first place, then they're stuck with the code that they have. Right, and the code that they have is probably pretty simple, and so it will only allow them to send balances to the exact address. And then Alice is stuck too, because she has a bunch of balances that are allocated to this address, and the function that's sitting at this address, she can't change either, because once you deploy Ethereum code, you can't change it. So she's stuck with a wallet that has a fallback function that nobody will be able to send money to. And the marketplace is stuck because they can only send money to the exact accounts or addresses that signed up, okay? And nobody realizes they're in trouble until Alice goes to withdraw. So it's already too late. She's already moved Ether onto it, okay? And so what you could do is you could end up with, if you don't have this sort of social convention, if you don't get everyone on the same page, that fallback functions absolutely, like if you want to send money and be able to receive money at a particular contract that you have, if you want money to be receivable to you, you really have to like either make your fallback function blank. So that's a very common thing, is that you just have an empty fallback function. Or if you really know what you're doing, you make sure that it will never consume more than 2300 gas. Okay, you need that as a social convention. Otherwise, money can get stuck. Okay, and this has happened. So there have been some wallet type applications where the story is a little more complicated, but basically their fallback function ended up consuming more gas. And so a lot of people there's money that's just sitting in Ethereum in contracts like this that will never be able to be moved because the place that you're trying to move it into has a fallback function that's consuming more than 2300 gas. And the function that's trying to move the money, it's written in such a way that it will only stake 2300 gas. Okay, so there's no way kind of around that to sort of circumvent that. Okay, and so this is a nice sort of technical solution, but a very important note is that it also requires a sort of social convention, which is that. That fallback functions that consume more than 2300 gas probably, you know, they're not going to work. They're not going to be compatible with a lot of contracts. Okay, so fallback functions that consume more than 23 gas will be incompatible with, we'll say, contracts using send or transfer to send and transfer money. Okay. So this is, anyways, this is a very significant issue. Okay. The other thing I'll do just in terms of a history lesson. So we have some examples of fallback functions. I'll also note that if you go to Solidity by Design, which is Ethereum Foundation sort of guideline to how to write smart contracts, you'll see in very clear terms when you get to the fallback function, there'll be like really, you know, sort of emphasized warnings telling you, you know, you have to be really careful. You should always leave this empty if you don't know what you're doing, you know. And when you read the warnings, you don't always know why they're telling you to do it, but they're very direct, and they try and make sure that you they basically try and steer you towards implementing a fallback function that is empty. So an empty fallback function is what we had in our actual contract itself. I don't have the code open anyways, but if you have function bracket bracket payable and then just have curly brace, then that's an empty fallback function. It won't consume any gas. And so it will always be able to be run. So anyways, they do try and steer you towards it. Okay. The final thing I'll say is that this whole reentry attack also happened in real life. So someone had an idea for an application. It was called the DAO, which was a decentralized autonomous organization. The idea of the contract was, if you've ever seen a show like Dragon's Den or Shark Tank, it was kind of like that in a decentralized space. So what would happen is people would buy shares of the DAO. They cost a certain amount of money in terms of Ether. And the Ether that they paid for their shares would go into a big pot of money. And the shares would allow them to vote. And so you kind of get like one vote per share. And so what would happen is people off the blockchain, they would propose business ideas. And then all the people that held shares would vote on whether they should fund this business venture or they should not fund this business venture. And if a business venture got enough votes, then the DAO contract would take money out of the pot, the Ether that was contributed to the in exchange for issuing the shares in the first place. It would take the money out of that pot and it would actually give it to the person who had this business venture idea. Okay. And so this was one of the first like kind of really serious contenders for something interesting that you might do on Ethereum that actually had deployed code. And so there was a lot of excitement about it. This is sort of my interpretation, but there were a lot of people that had Ether and they didn't really have much to do with it. So for whatever reason, it ended up raising a ton of Ether, a very substantial amount of even the total of all Ether that was available on the entire Ethereum network. And then what happened is it was a lot more complicated. It was sort of a disguised form of this, but it was vulnerable to this attack. And so no one really knew about this attack before. It had been kind of proposed on some like developer forums and things like that. People had sort of pointed out, but people didn't have a real, you know, it didn't crystallize for people that were involved in Ethereum that this was actually a very serious attack. And exactly, it's kind of complicated and exactly what's triggering it and what the conditions would be to actually turn it into an attack and all of that type of stuff wasn't well understood. So the DAO came out, it was vulnerable to this attack. At least one person figured it out and actually drained all the money out of the pot. Well, not all of it, but a substantial amount of money out of the pot using this kind of attack. Now, the DAO was kind of weird because it didn't let you just withdraw your money directly. I won't go through the details. It's kind of complicated and it's very specific to how the DAO was set up. And the DAO was like really complicated, like probably overly complicated in terms of how it was set up. But for complicated reasons that I won't go into, it wasn't a straight withdrawal. What happened is the person could have eventually got the money out, but it would take about 30 days for them to get the money out of the contract itself. So the Ethereum project worked really, really fast. And they said, well, what we can do, and this is a big lesson for Bitcoin, blockchain, Ethereum, is they said, you know what, you know, we say that blockchains are immutable, that you can't change them, but you can change them if you have consensus. So if everybody agrees that a record should be changed or that the rules should be changed or something like that, if you can get the consensus of the network, you'll result in this hard fork, okay? So people who don't update won't they won't be compatible. It won't be interoperable between the people who do update and don't update, okay? But with a hard fork and enough people who agree to update, then you can actually do whatever you want, including going back in time and, you know, stopping attacks from happening. So basically what they did is they, and it was nice, it only worked in this case because the money was locked up for 30 days. It didn't start circulating. Okay, once it starts circulating, you could roll all of those transactions back, but then you would be taking money out of people who weren't the attacker, people who got money from the attacker not realizing that this was money from an attack. Okay, so because the money was sort of quarantined for 30 days and it didn't mix in with the rest of the ether, what they were able to do is they basically pushed an update that said, hey, you know all that money that's sitting over here? Yeah, that doesn't belong to the attacker anymore. It belongs to people who originally had put money into the DAO project, and then there was a way to withdraw the money. You have to show up and prove that you had put some ether originally into the DAO, and then you could withdraw from that money. Okay, so on a blockchain level, it looks sort of like this, where basically the attack happens here. And then let's assume that that we didn't do this update. Then 30 days later, the attacker sort of gets the money. So the attacker gets the money. And then once they get the money, then they can start spending it, sending it to other people and things like that. And so it sort of starts mixing in with all the rest of the Ethereum. So what the Ethereum project says is, okay, before this happens, what we're going to do is we're going to create a new blockchain, and we're just going to have a rule that basically this attack never happened. And so how you set that up is a little complicated. You can read about it. The details of it are very interesting. But basically, we have a special transaction here that effectively, that's illegal, okay? So it's not an allowed transaction under the rules of Ethereum. But because everybody here have updated, they've updated specifically to allow this illegal. So you have an invalid transaction that's now valid under the new update, and it basically reverts the attack in a way that's kind of interesting. But we'll just think of it as somehow they were able to reverse the attack. Okay, and then everyone goes on their merry way. Okay, and so this turns out to be the path that Ethereum took, and there were some people who said, hey, you know what, this is like totally against the principles of Ethereum. In Ethereum, you know, transactions should never be reversed, even if they're, it's stolen money, it's clearly demonstrable that it was stolen. You know, this is just philosophically, is totally against the principles of what blockchain is about and what, you know, cryptocurrencies are about and things like that. And so what we want to do is we want to not install this update. We're purposely not going to install this update, and we're going to allow the attacker to keep their money, and we'll just keep going. We'll keep developing this blockchain, okay? And so that became a separate project called Ethereum Classic. And this creates all these sort of weird kind of side effects, because Ethereum Classic, so it's sort of its own blockchain. Ethereum is its own blockchain. First off, it's very confusing which one's which and things like that. I can say that Ethereum, in terms of if you want to use the exchange rate of Ether and Ether Classic, if you want to use the exchange rate as an indication of which was more successful, you know, this trades for about 10 times the amount of this. It might be a different multiple by the time you watch this video. So the market definitely is sort of down here. They think that this is the sort of predominant chain, but nobody thinks that this chain is worth zero. Okay, so it's worth some amount of money, just not exactly zero. And what's really weird is if you owned Ether, pretend that you, you know, were given Ether in this block here, then your Ether turns into both Ether under Ethereum Classic and you have Ether under the updated Ethereum. So it's kind of like you have two coins. You have a coin on this chain and you have a coin on this chain. And you can sell this for some amount of money and you could sell this other one for some amount of money. And there's sort of complicated security issues where if you try and spend it here, maybe someone rebroadcasts it here and it ends up moving in both places. But anyways, it raised all sorts of interesting questions. Now, one consequence of this is people thought, hey, this is actually a really interesting way to settle disputes. So if there's ever a group of people who don't like the way a blockchain project is going, then they'll just start their own chain. They'll just sort of fork off the chain and they'll start their own chain. And so we saw back in Bitcoin's case that people have done something similar where there were a bunch of people that were pushing a certain update to Bitcoin. Bitcoin was hesitating, and so they just splintered off their own chain called Bitcoin Cash. And then more recently, around the time that I'm recording this, the Bitcoin Cash project has also kind of split into two again, where there's some disagreement about other proposals. So this is one way to sort of resolve disputes, is that everyone just sort of goes their own way, and then the market kind of decides which coin that they're going to back. Okay, so anyways, hopefully that's an interesting story. That concludes everything I want to say about Ethereum and Solidity. I know I barely scratched the surface of it, but hopefully it gave you some indication of how easy it is to use, to develop, although how complicated it might be to make your contract secure. So in the next lectures, what we'll do is we'll transition to use cases. And I'll see you then.